I send in off to go straight. And I have to admit that today we did the same thing, because actually our reading is not from the 12th chapter of Luke, it's from the 12th chapter of John. So, 6 days before the Passover, Jesus came to Bethany, the home of Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. And they gave a dinner for him. And Martha served, and Lazarus was one of those at the table with him. And Mary took a pound of costly perfume made of pure nard, and she anointed Jesus' feet and wiped them with her hair. The house was filled with the fragrance of the perfume. But Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, the one who was about to betray him, said, "Why was this perfume not sold for 300 denarii and the money given to the poor?" He said this not because he cared about the poor, but because he was a thief, and he kept the common purse and used to steal what was put into it. And Jesus said, "Leave her alone. She bought it so that she might keep it for the day of my burial. You always will have the poor with you, but you do not always have me." When the great crowd of the Jews learned that he was there, they came not only because of Jesus, but also to see Lazarus, whom he had raised from the dead. So the chief priests planned to put Lazarus to death as well, since it was on account of him that many of the Jews were deserting and were beginning to believe in Jesus. The next day, the crowd had come to a festival to hear that Jesus was coming to Jerusalem. Here it ends today's reading of the Gospel. Let us pray. O gracious God, open our eyes that we may see you leading us. Open our ears that we might hear your voice calling to us. Open our minds that we might understand your will for us. And open our hearts that we might be moved to service. That by the power of your Spirit, we might honor your love for us and live lives that reflect that profound love to the whole world. Amen. Now that is a most profound gospel. There's a lot of stuff going on in this gospel reading. There's a lot of human emotion, grief, joy, celebration, death. There's a lot going on in this gospel reading. Of course, two things stand out. It's Mary's extravagant display of her love for Jesus. And of course, it's Judas's practical response. But let's put something in context. Let's get it in context a little bit. Bethany, this town, I have read some very convincing arguments which say that this town, this Bethany, was probably Jesus' favorite place to be. When he wanted to get away from it and enjoy the fellowship of those people that he loved, he didn't go home to Nazareth. For crying out loud, they tried to kill him. Jerusalem was not going to be any better, the big city. Whenever he was anywhere else in his land, he was hounded by the crowds. True, when he wanted to pray, meditate, maybe even do a little fasting, Jesus would go to the desert to be alone. But when he wanted to unwind, when he wanted to be around those whom he loved, he went to Bethany. Bethany, which is only about 3 miles distant from Jerusalem. So there you go. It is a suburb. Even back then, Bethany was a suburb. So don't feel so guilty. Jesus liked being in the suburb as well. 3 miles away. Close enough to be exciting to the big city, but far enough away, especially back in those days, that it was a slower pace. Heck, fire. Even today, I can make those 3 miles in about 30 minutes or so. Close enough to get there, far enough away. But there's a lot of things going on here. Not just the fact that he loved this place where he had raised Lazarus from the dead. He loved this place because of the people he was with, because of Mary, because of Martha, those whom he loved. But we have to be very, very upfront about this. The two things that stand out are not necessarily the context in which this happens. The two things that stand out are the juxtaposition between Mary and Judas, who raises a very practical question. My God, we could have sold this perfume for all this money and give it away to the poor. This is a practical consideration. No matter what we think of Judas's motivations, no matter even regardless of what John tells us in this gospel, we have to acknowledge it's a very practical, a very even generous way of looking at a problem like this. And if nothing else, we're all the descendants of practical people. If we weren't, I have a feeling that that line of DNA extinguished somewhere among the impracticalities generations ago. This was a very practical matter. This is something we have to consider. This is a thought that should cross our minds. What do we do with this kind of extravagance? What do we do about the poor? Now, generations of people have always used Jesus' response as a way of saying, well, let's not pay any attention to the poor. Don't worry about that. And of course, that is not what Jesus is asking here or anywhere else, for that matter, in the gospel. Here we have John telling us that Judas has been a critic. Judas is just saying this. He's posturing. He's not being true to the calling that he's been called to. John wants us to know that up front. Kind of reminds me of the story about the Hindu, the rabbi, and the critic who are traveling and get caught out in a storm. And the closest place that they can get to seek shelter is a farmhouse. And the farmer says, well, I've got room for two, but not for three. One of you is going to have to spend the night in the barn. And the Hindu man says, well, what's a little suffering for a man from India? I'd be glad to go to sleep in the barn. So he goes out. He makes his bed in the barn. A short time later, there's a knock at the door. The farmer opens up his door, and there's the Hindu man. And he says, I apologize. I didn't understand. In your barn, you have cows. These are sacred animals to my religion. I couldn't possibly bed down in front of a symbol of God. I must find someplace else to rest. At that point, the Jewish man says, the rabbi says, oh, I'll go out. Don't worry. So he goes out. And of course, a few minutes later, as it comes a knock at the door, you already know what I'm going to say. Unfortunately, there are pigs. There's swine out there. To me, this is a hateful thing, and I cannot possibly bed down in the presence of swine. Is there any possibility that there's a place for me inside? At this point, the critic says, okay, fine. I'll go out. So he goes out. And yes, a few minutes later comes the knock at the door. It's the cow and the pig. Critics are never a welcome voice. Critics are never something we all want to hear, but sometimes we have to hear it. And even in the context of biblical and Judas and gift to the poor, it doesn't hurt us a little bit to hear that criticism. And to consider it well and careful. But of course, as important as Judas's response to Mary's gift, there's something profound about that. There's something so powerful about a woman who brings in such a costly gift and cracks it open and pours it, anoints the feet of Jesus, and and wipes his feet off with her hair. One, that's a lot of money. That's enough money to support a family in that day and age for over a year. That's an extravagant gift by any measure. That's raising big issues, which actually goes along with kind of what Judas was saying. But here's something else going on. She does this. She does this with her hair. This is a time in which unmarried people of opposite sex never touched each other, much less touched their feet, much less let their hair down in front of each other warming. I don't know whether I should tell you this or not, but in Hebrew, when I studied Hebrew in seminary, to wash one's feet in biblical Hebrew is a euphemism, an explicit euphemism for having sex. It's that level of intimacy that John is communicating to us right now. I don't know that they had sex, but I do know that this is how close this woman felt to Jesus. And what must the other people in that room have thought when she let her hair down and wiped his feet? A profound statement of intimacy, of love, of gratitude, in a way which I don't think we understand today. But even in its naked form, it catches us. It should catch us. Wow, something really strong and powerful is going on here. John is trying to tell us something important here. She anoints his feet. She doesn't anoint his head, because if not to anoint a head, kings were anointed on the head in ancient Israel and in current England as well. The king, when he is crowned, is anointed on the head. This is something different. This is something profound. She anointed his feet with something so amazing. Now, for me, the question comes to what were the voices that these two people were listening to? Why were these two people listening to two such different voices? We have the image, the cartoon image, if you will, of the angel sitting on one shoulder and the devil sitting on the other. Do this, do this, do this. Nobody's gonna see it. Now, don't you do that. And if we kind of apply this to Judas and to Mary, it really becomes a cartoon. Judas is just listening to his devil. And really, truly, we cannot dismiss it that easily. That wouldn't be really not good. But there is something that they're listening to. Contrast these two voices that they're listening to. One, the voice of generosity, of intimacy, of love. The other, a voice of posturing, of criticizing, of not being very supportive. They are listening to two separate voices. So the question is, how do we listen to voices? What are the voices that we listen to? What are the thoughts that we give credence to? What is it that you do to pay attention to your life? I don't know about you, but I don't often feel like I got an angel on one shoulder and a devil on the other to give me guidance. The choices aren't that stark. They aren't that apparent. They're much more complex, much more nuanced, if you will. So the question is, how do we make decisions? What do we do with this voice? What do we do with this situation? I was talking to a friend of mine, and he counsels addicts down in Anne Arundel County. And he was talking to a young man, and the discussion had gone around to how you make your choices. What are the choices that you make? You know, the devil on one shoulder, the angel on the other. And this young man said, you know, it's not like that for me. How is it, Jay asked him. He said, on one hand, it's the voice of life, and on the other, it's the voice of death. That's a pretty stark choice. I wish it was that stark for us. I think it would be a lot easier for us on a day-to-day basis if we could make those kind of choices, if we could discern those choices out of what life gives us. I would wish that that could be so. Maybe it is for you. Maybe it is in some situations for me. But it isn't like that all the time. It isn't like that at all. Not even most of the time for me. I struggle with what I can do. I struggle with what I decide. And I understand that sometimes those decisions that I make may have consequences. And so if that is true, I'm afraid I tend to not make them. I delay, I postpone, I prevaricate. I may even do a little posturing. I try not to face up to them sometimes. That is in and of itself a sort of sin, a wasting of the gift that we have been given, the gift of life. That's what this passage is about. What we do with life, how we respond to that gift that has been given us. Unfortunately, sometimes these choices that we make, these decisions that we do, these consequences that we suffer are like a rifle shot on a battlefield. Sometimes the bullet is fired and you never hear it before it strikes you. It's only after you make the decision that you really understand what happens. But that is no excuse. We can't use that as an excuse for just doing what one friend of mine calls the analysis paralysis. It really is about receiving the gift that we have been given and responding to it as best we can, as fully as we can, as wholeheartedly as we can. Patricia Wall is the pastor of First United Church of Christ in Berkeley, California. And this is what she said. Performing acts like the one Mary did are acts of extravagant care that remind us that we are called to be equal partners with each other and that we ought to be humbled as we come together before God. Acts of humility and love are empowering. They remind us that through power, control, and domination of the ways of the world, there are some places where a simple gesture of kindness and caring still count and still make a difference. If you act out of love, what have you lost? If you stand up for love, what have you lost? Not too long ago, they unveiled a statue to Rosa Parks in Statuary Hall on Capitol Hill. In some sense of the word, this is a woman who reacted out of love, who stood up for love, who got from the back of the bus and sat down where she was not allowed out of love. And in that sense, she did the right thing. She suffered some severe consequences because of it, but she did the right thing. And because of what she did, stuff happened. The world changed in profound ways. In the part of the world that I grew up in, things were never the same after she stood up out of an act of simple love. Because that's what it was, an act of love. A friend of mine was telling me that he had some stuff in the garage that he had been hanging on to. And he thought, well, maybe what I ought to do is sell it Why? I don't use it anymore. It's just useless stuff sitting up there. And what? And waste not, want not. That's what he says. That's what the saying says. Why throw away something perfectly good when I can make some money on it, right? Why don't I just sell it? And he is right. He is right. We have a habit of hanging on to things that might have a little value. Giving away something that could be turned into a little cash, that would be unavoidable. That's just unthinkable. That wouldn't make any sense. But as this one friend said, when does love have to make sense? What we do day by day, how we love, how we choose to stand up for justice, how we fight for peace, it doesn't make much sense sometimes. There are times when the consequences of that just don't seem apparent. When we give some extravagance to something that doesn't seem to make sense, and yet it makes all kinds of sense. Like Reverend Long says, there is a place in the world where a simple act of kindness, of love, of justice, of peace, which may not conform to how the world is, can change it. And that's what we're called to do. Yes, you will love and you may lose. I know something about that. You may make a decision and it will not turn out the way you had hoped. That is very true. But what have you lost? In the end, what have you lost in any act of love, in any act of opening your heart, of any act of reaching out to somebody who hasn't had as good a time of it as you have? What have we lost as a congregation by stepping out in faith and doing something extraordinary for each other, for this community, for God? We may come up short. We may be disappointed in the results, but in the end, what have we lost by standing up for love and pouring out a perfume which fills the air with the scent of life as opposed to death? So yes, I do love each and every one of you. May God bless each and every one.